What's up? I'm Dan Fredenberg, and this is another Chance Encounter. Hey, what's up? I'm Dan Fredenberg. I'm a commercial real estate guy. I'm from the internet. We're seeing more properties like this being built in front of a house. Going to be torn down soon. I understand that there are power lines that are just kind of close. What's up again? This is Dan Fredenberg, and that there is a commercial real estate building. I'm joined today with, okay, now I get to try out my Japanese skills again. So the Yukiko is how I'd take for the first part, and then Nakayama, my guess.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, so how'd I do? Do you want to hit me with it one time so I can hear how it's properly pronounced?
It's Yukiko Nakayama.
Nakayama. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. All right, cool. So now I got the intonation. Cool. But for those of you who are new to Chance Encounters, maybe you haven't seen one before, and this is not a show about pronouncing Japanese or Asian languages in general, oddly enough. But I interview commercial real estate investors, and I go through the five different motivations I've found that investors tend to have as far as why they're continuing to make acquisitions or looking to expand their portfolio. And I say, which one's you? And then I go through the six different roles in a commercial real estate deal, and I say, which one's your core competency? And you can go to dandoesdeals.com to download your own Dan Does Deal die, so you can print it out, you can explain it to your family and all that kind of stuff. But that's the main thing I'm looking for, is making sure that we all have a network of people where we can effectively communicate with each other. And speaking about effectively communicating and being successful, if you want to be successful, I think you have to be able to effectively communicate who you are. So Yukiko, could you please introduce yourself for the audience?
Yes, my name is Yukiko Nakayama. I started my investment journey from 2007. Since then, I did single family flip, small apartment building, condo conversion, infill redevelopment project in Washington, DC. And had a master in the real estate development degree from George Mason University, and I'm continuing to learning about commercial, you know, real estate business, and then also, you know, looking for my next commercial project, which most likely a self-storage facility.
All right, beautiful. And so the next step, the next segment in this show is we go through the motivation, and to do that, I need to go over here, and I have to hit this button right there, and then I hit this button right there, and ta-da, there it is. So I go through the motivation first, because sometimes beginners are on this show and they don't know what role they're going to play, but they do at least know what their motivation is. But again, this is to help you in the audience effectively communicate on these different subjects when it comes to commercial real estate. So the first motivation that people have is to preserve their purchasing power. Okay, if you are relying on the cash flow that comes from your wealth to make ends meet, this is you, okay? Because this is what REITs are up to. They're all making all these extra acquisitions because inflation is making that cash flow it's coming from worth less. So they need to have more assets bringing in more cash. And so that's their motivation to pick up their next property, is to preserve that purchasing power. The next reason is my one, which is to trade time for wealth. My background is in tech, mass marketing, and the technology to accept payments online, that kind of fun stuff. And so I am on the high earner side as far as salaries go. But the problem is then you're also paying the largest amount of tax you possibly can, which is from income tax. And mm-hmm. So it hit me, it's like, well, I should probably pivot over to something where I'm exchanging my time for wealth. I'm getting equity. I'm on the GP team, and that's how I end up building my wealth instead of paying income tax and then shooing it away. But the next reason is the most common one, which is people want to fast track their retirement. And there are two things in that idea that are implied. Just I like to explain them so nobody ends up looking like a dummy on this show. The first one is that if you're in your early 20s and you're saying, oh, I'm fast tracking my retirement, it's like, oh, no, you're not. Okay, if you know anything about economics, you know, it's like, no, nah, there's nothing you can do in your 20s to make sure that when you're 80, you're still like pretty much okay, unless you're actually going for total passive income, large amounts of wealth. But fast track retirement, the other main thing is it means that one day you're not going to want to hustle as much. Okay, maybe you're going to move to a place with a low cost of living. And and so that's one reason why people want to fast track retirement. But the next one, those are the people who will never quit. They'll never retire. They're very, very ambitious. Buy their whole hometown, and you know, maybe they want a skyscraper or you know, the biggest yacht in the pier or something. But these are the ones who will keep on. They're motivated to hustle until they die. But that's in contrast to the last one, the fifth one, which is that some people pick a segment of society, and or maybe it's the environment, or maybe it's animals, something like that, and they say, I really want to help this. I really want to make an impact in this area. And they realize that accumulating wealth is the best way out there to make that sort of impact. So they've basically got some cause that they're looking to forward. So of those five different motivations, what best describes you? What combination of those?
I think it's like a fast track to the retirement. You know, I really didn't know like my dreams or my like a dream profession. Like, you know, some people want to be a pilot, some people want to be a, you know, doctor or something, but I really didn't have like specific, you know, so I need to make money like the best I can and then retire early to do something else, like what maybe like, you know, when I had a financial freedom. So that's why I got the MBA, and after MBA, I got this, you know, six-figure consulting firm. I worked for a while, and then stuff like that. I was trying to maximize my income at the time so that I can retire early to do, you know, something that I might like, you know, after my retirement. So that was that was me.
I've been saying it a lot frequently because, you know, like, as I said, you know, I've got the background in tech, so that's similar. And I figured that if you work hard and you're in that sort of field, then, you know, you don't have to play the game of finance. But I've found that you can either play the game of finance or you can lose. Those are your only two choices. You really have to be involved in building equity if you really want to have a stable plan that'll last like 30 years in the future, whatever it happens to be. But let's go through the different roles to find out where that's going to be. And so I understand that some of you in the audience don't know anything about commercial real estate. And so I'm going to take you right from the bottom and say the, you know, simplest way of putting it. So first, I'm going to explain what a repositioner is. A repositioner is a person, I've got a bunch of different properties here because they're also in acquisitions. And so that means because they're in acquisitions, they have to do something called underwriting of a bunch of different properties, which means just doing the math, just figuring out, does this property actually even make as much money as they say it does? And what they're really looking for, and why it's called a repositioner, is they're repositioning it for upside. And so what are the tricks of the trade as far as finding upside? Well, the first one is better operations. You stop that money from going down the toilet, but you know, there are other things in efficient operations. There's also a marketing piece, which is the leasing agent part, making sure that vacancy stays low. But that's one way you can get operations. You can get upside for the property, but that's probably not enough right now in the market today. So a lot of repositioners will get a contractor team so that they can charge more rent once it's nicer. They can just get those contractors to make the place nicer, but and that's good enough for a lot of people. But if you're from the internet like I am, you're gonna have a problem. You're gonna need a local. You're gonna need boots on the ground. You're gonna need somebody who can be there in an hour, because it's not gonna be me. Okay, I'm from the internet, as I said. So normally, if you're a resident of a building, you probably think that those guys are the owners, but of course it's not that simple. If you want to buy a property that's worth tens of millions of dollars or something like that, you're going to have to go to a bank, you're going to have to go to some capital raisers, you're going to have to go to some financiers and say, hey, can I borrow tens of millions of dollars for this property? Now, the question that they're going to be asking, though, that's not going to occur to you, and in a lot of coaching programs, they kind of skip over this part. Mm-hmm. They're going to say, who's your sponsor? Who's your KP? Okay. Mm-hmm. So even if the richest man on earth, Elon Musk right now, if he decides he wants to buy a 350 or a 1,500 unit apartment complex or a portfolio or something like that, if he wants to get a loan, he needs somebody who already owns a similar asset. Okay. So you have to have somebody who already has the 350 unit apartment complex or the 1500 unit apartment complex, whatever, or else they're not going to lend you the money. Now, right. On top of that, there's a little bit of liquidity that needs to be shown. And then there needs to be a balance sheet of at least the amount of the loan. But right. You put that all together and you have yourself a commercial real estate deal. So, you could go, what is the core competency or main role that you'll contribute to your next deal more likely than not out of those plan?
I think I'm a repositioning, like a value add. So mm-hmm. Typically when I do the small apartment deals, my repositions strategy is add more rooms so that one bedroom become a four bedroom so that rent jump from, almost nothing to $5,000 in Washington, D.C., something like that. It's very radical. And then, increase the value of the building, so much. So that's kind of very easy to make and then very clear pictures. You know what I mean? I think most of the multifamilies usually increase rent, 2% or, somehow increase operations and then reduce the cost. I think it's, to me, it's a little more challenging, So I like add the values and then just increase the, the price, the value of the building. That's I like. Yeah.
I love that. And I know that a lot of people, when you say a one bedroom into a four bedroom, they're like what is this black magic? But I lived in Taiwan for 15 years and you've been to Japan, I'm sure. Right, exactly. So the thing that makes me laugh about that is I often see in these commercial real estate, these multifamily investors, I'm suspicious a lot of them have never lived in an apartment. Mm-hmm. And if you've spent a lot of time living in apartments, then you have a much better idea of, is this place in actually well taken care of? How do you make the difference when it's as competitive as it is in Japan or Taiwan? It's the level of competition is just mind blowing, right? Mm-hmm. So that's really fun. So I like that part. And as far as your sweetheart properties, I call it my buy box, your buy box. And in other words, that is what property could you describe in terms of geographic areas, unit count, and class? What's easier for you to say yes to, and what's more difficult to say no to? So, where in America, unit count, and class?
To me, very good area in Washington, D.C., good area, high rent. But somehow the unit count maybe, four plus, and then it's, somehow this, distress, maybe conditions or situations. So we buy, very inexpensively, even it's a good area. And then mm-hmm. we put the money to make really nice high end, and mm-hmm. then put the, the renters in there, and then maximize unit count by, designing with the architect, comply with DC code and everything, and make sure we have very solid, unit so that attract the tenant.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Great. That's awesome. And so we ended up meeting through it was Yona's challenge on LinkedIn, right? So is LinkedIn the best way to reach out to you, or is there a website that's better? Or
LinkedIn is good. I get a lot of people contacting me in the LinkedIn.
Oh, okay, great. Yeah, and is like I know I've known some Makikos and Mamikos. Is your name a common name in Japanese? Like, are there a lot of you?
Somewhat, you know, like it's not very popular, but it's kind of medium popular.
Okay. So all right. So is there something else that like where we can be sure that that it's you more or less? Well, I guess you know you've got a pretty good shot of your face there, so I guess you know, you make sure you can, if you want to, you can connect with you could go that way. So and yeah. Also I have, sorry, what's that?
Yeah, definitely. I have, you know, like a kind of the you know, showing the whole you know, so I think you can find very easily.
Oh, okay, it's a full body shot or something like that. It's not just like, you know, going like something like that. Okay, yeah, YouTube will love that bit for its automatic thumbnails. But speaking of YouTube, I have something to ask you in the camera, which is if you look just under my left hand, there's a very festive looking, very Christmassy looking button, and same with Lunar New Year. Red is very popular and it's a good thing this time of year, but in general the red button is bad, okay? Mm-hmm. And the way to make the red button good is you just have to click on it and then it turns gray, okay? Mm-hmm. And what that means is that YouTube knows that they should pay me for these videos, okay? Mm-hmm. And it doesn't cost you anything, okay? So, but pretty please make sure that you hit that subscribe button, and it just means that these videos might show up on your list of suggestions. But Yukiko, as far as people to reach out to you though, I want to make sure that we've got the best person that you can help right now. So out of these different groups, you know, everybody in commercial real estate loves to help each other, but without breaking any SEC rules, so you can't entice investors, that's against the law, at least unless you have a 506c raise, but who can you help more in real estate than anybody else?
I think like any people who are looking to purchase small apartment building, I'm actually teach at the REA USA, so you know they can connect me there also. And then I have meetup, you know, like just, you know, regular real estate questions that you may have. You know, those are that meetup is completely free online. So it's called Real Estate Investor Forums. You know, I started at the coffee shop, but since pandemic, we start doing the online. So, I, you know, in general, everyday investor who want to, you know, make some extra money by investing like a small apartment building. And then, you know, I can share my, you know, past experience making money, and then, you know, in the future, if I have any offering in future for self storage, of course, you know, people who might be interested in those commercial building, I can help you with that, you know, to make a return.
Beautiful. So that's how you can help, Yukiko. And thank you so much for watching. You've done me a huge favor from watching, but please do make sure you hit that subscribe button. But thank you, Yukiko. That's easy for me to say now. Thanks for joining me today. It's been fantastic getting to know you better.
Thank you so much, Dan. I appreciate this opportunity.
Awesome. Thank you.
I just want to tell you, because I've actually seen your website, Real Estate as a Scam, before, and I loved it.
Oh, cool.
So, yeah, because I think it's really so spot on. There's good stuff, bad stuff in every industry.
Yeah, make sure you subscribe, like, and hit that notification bell for Dan the Man.
And thank you. I turned that subscribe button from red like his beard to gray like his beard will be.
So I met Dan through some networking groups for real estate investing. He's a great guy from what I know about him. He's very ambitious, and he makes it easy to come on with his questions and has a great setup. It's easy, it's clear, concise, and I'd recommend going on his interviews for anyone that's considering it.
It was unlike anything I've ever experienced. It was super fun. The process was so easy, a caveman can do it. I mean, if you guys haven't done it yet, you guys need to get on his calendar. just take 15 minutes of your time, get exposure, find out who Dan is, what he's about. He's a true trifecta. And if you don't know who he is, get in touch with him. Google his name, find him on LinkedIn, do whatever you can, just reach out to him.
So I really appreciate the format. Like I've told you a couple times before, I think it's really great because me personally, I'm very long-winded. I have to purposefully make things more concise, but the way I take things in is I definitely prefer things to be concise and straight to the point and concentrated. And the chance encounters really do that great for individuals. So you can get a good grasp on who they are, what do they do, why do they do it, what space do they operate in. That's why I love chance encounters.